Well, good morning. How are you guys? Good. Praise the Lord. You know, I didn't want to make it a series, but it's kind of like a series. We came out of this series of Go Fish, and that's witnessing, bringing people in. And then I felt the Lord say, and I think the reason why a lot of us feel inadequate is because we're not living in the life of a Christian, really. I mean, we come to Sunday. By the way, listen to me. Coming to church Sunday morning does not make us believers or Christians. Amen? You guys remember when Jesus cast out the demons in a man who was in the synagogue? That was right in church. It's like probably right in the middle of the hymnal. I have no idea when it happened, but it happened. And coming to church doesn't make us saved. It's when we're trusting in Jesus. And then once we're trusting in Jesus, he calls us to live a life for him. And sometimes we still kind of cling on to the old life. And because of that, we feel we really can't witness to our friends who know the true us, kind of. I'm going totally off the cuff here, but one of the things about the church people is they're some of the best people who put on the face. I'm not putting anyone down. I'm just being, because I remember me. We put on a face. Everything's fine. Everything's fine. Everything's great. My life is, you know, but yet my marriage is really struggling. My kids, I'm having trouble with my kids. My own doubts, my own personal doubts, this addiction I may have. But then when we come Sunday morning, on goes the mask. And God doesn't want us to live a life like that. Because then we're doing things secretly, and then we feel even more ashamed. And the devil just brings condemnation upon condemnation and just really wants to rob from us. God loves you. God knows what you're doing, knows what I'm doing. God knows the things that we struggle with. And yet he is patient, kind, and loving, and he wants to heal us of all those things. And he wants to use us. He wants to use us in reaching people and bringing them into the kingdom of God. And so I feel led that we should go into talking about the holiness of God, which we talked about last week. And this week we're going to talk about us and the holy living that God has called us to. God is holy. And we learn some of the attributes of it. And he's separate. He's so different from all of his creation. And he's holy. And he's called us to be holy. He's called you and I to be holy like he is. And we need Jesus, and we need that. But he gives us instructions. He doesn't just say, be holy, I'll be right back. No, he tells us. He tells us how we can walk it out on a day-to-day basis. And so that's what we're here today to learn about. By the way, how many of you guys have a Bible that says, what does it say on it? Does it say, Holy Bible? You ever wonder why it says, Holy Bible? How about this? Israel. Israel is called what? The Holy Land. And in Jerusalem, it's called the Holy City. What is it about these three things right there they all have in common, why they have the name holy? It's because they belong to God. They belong to God. God's word belongs to him. It was his letter to us. He spoke it through the Holy Spirit and allowed them to write it down. And he's called New Jerusalem. It's going to be the Holy City in Israel's holy. Anything that belongs to God is holy, because remember last week we learned this. Anything that God touches, he makes it holy. Isn't that awesome? And so God wants us, he wants us to allow him to touch our lives so that we can be holy. God wants a holy people. And he's patient and he will work with us. Amen? So we learn about that. God wants to make us holy. There's another part of holiness. He's touched us. We have his spirit inside of us. We are saved. We are a brand new creation. We are holy. Now, he wants us to walk it out every single day. What's on the inside, he wants us to walk it out so that we're walking, talking, thinking, and doing things in a holy way, in a fashion, just the way he's called us. And that's where we fail. And that's where the devil comes in and condemns us. And it causes us to shrink back. God wants us to walk out this holiness in our lives that he has put there. Amen. He wants it on the outside as well. So many times the world tries to start on the outside hoping they can change the inside. God says, no, I change the inside, and then it's going to work itself out in your life if you're obedient and if you surrender to it. And it will happen. Amen. I want you to know this. It will happen if you allow it. It will happen if you allow it. So I want to talk about the day-to-day stuff, living in this sin-stained world. And before I begin, I want to make this point right off the beginning. I am not the poster child for holiness or purity. I'm not. Can you identify? We're not. Barry, yeah. We're not. We are not the poster child for what is really holy. I mean, matter of fact, many of us have spent a big part of our lives cloaked in secrecy, in shame and in pain and the things that this world has put on us and that we've involved ourselves in. We're cloaked in that. And so we kind of hide. But I want you to know the world is broken that way. And God wants to make you and I, we are made holy, and he wants to work it out in our lives. And just as the world, it's not just the world, by the way, it's suffering. It's not just the world that's broken. Listen to me. It's also the church as well. Let me give you some statistics. There's a lady by the name of Dana. A lady by the name of Dana. And she has a ministry called Revive Our Hearts. I don't know if you know her. I'm sorry, I don't know her last name. But I watched a video. You know who she is? Great lady. And I watched this video, which was 3 years ago, and she gave these statistics. And I want to give you the statistics as well. And this is about the church. Again, God's called us to walk holy lives. But we're broken too. Virtually, there is no statistical difference in the church versus the unchurched women who've read the erotica book, 50 Shades of Grey, or maybe watched the movie. And then when you think about it, and I've heard that this movie is very, it's erotica. And so there's no difference between the church and the world. 64% of men in the church view porn once a month. And in doing so, causes shame, causes damage to their relationship, and even damage with their wives or those women around them. 64% in the church. About 40% of all the abortions that happen come from the church. That's sad. I mean, it's heartbreaking. And look, we're not here judging. If you've been through that, listen, God's here to heal. You listen, please. Don't shut off because the devil says, you hear what he's saying? Look what he's pointing out. God loves us. God forgives us. There's nothing that my God can't forgive and can't heal. And so even though that's happening, it's happening within the church 40%. That's sad. Adultery, divorce. Sadly, that's not as uncommon in the church as it is in the world. We are broken and we are wounded. And God wants to heal. Remember, holiness means this. One of the things holiness means, it means set apart. You're different. God is different. God has rescued you and I, and he's called us to be different. But when we look just like the rest of the world looks at us and they say, I don't want what you have. There's nothing different between you and I. And so it destroys our testimony, and we know it. And that's the reason why we don't do it. And not only that, the world looks at us and says, you're a hypocrite. And for that reason, they say, for this very excuse, they totally reject Jesus Christ because of these statistics. True? Yeah. God wants to change that in our lives. He wants us to walk out in holiness and purity. You can. This is not who we're going to be. This is not who God rescued us from. God rescued us to be just like his son. And we can. Amen. I want to encourage you. I don't want to leave you down going, oh, that was a great message. Yeah. No, I want you to know God loves us and God can do a work in healing in our lives. So, we see the same thing when God rescued the Jews. Remember the Jews, the Hebrew children? They started off, God gave them a promise of the promised land, and during hard times, they made their way over to Egypt, and then they multiplied to millions. Millions, and now they're growing, and they're a big nation, but they're within the nation of the Egyptians. And next thing you know, the Egyptians, who did not worship the God of the Hebrews, did not worship the God of Jacob, did not worship that God whatsoever, but I tell you what, they worshiped many other gods, false gods, lies, and they did detestable things as well. And then what they did with these Jews, they made them their own slaves, made them do whatever they wanted. They were harsh to them. They put a heavy burden upon their back. They treated them harshly. They beat them. They immersed them inside their pagan culture to the point that these Jews were following some of the cultures that the Egyptians were doing. Not only that, they had to do whatever the king bidded of them. You will do this. You will do that. And then it got to a point that they treated them very harshly and even started murdering their children. This king which they were slaves to. That's what was happening. And not only that, this king kept them from the promised land that God wanted them to go to. But you guys know the story. God sent Moses, did a miracle after miracle after miracle, and God delivered these people out of the hands of their oppressors and out of the hands of their slave drivers and slave masters, and brought them out of that land of Egypt into the promised land where he wanted them to be. He rescued them. He redeemed them. It took a long time to work Egypt out of them. And by the way, that's called sanctification, and it's what God's doing in us too. But listen, God has rescued you and I from our oppressor, the devil. Bible says that we were slaves to sin. Slaves to sin. And we had to obey whatever the devil wanted us to do. You say, I do what I want to do. Yeah, that's the devil right there. That's the devil right there. And we think, you know, we had to do what he said. We thought the things. We had the attitudes. And we were an enemy of God at the time. But God came in and rescued us when we cried out to him. He rescued us. He delivered us out of the hands of the enemy. He put his spirit inside of us. He made us more than conquerors if we follow what he calls us to do. That's what our God has done for us. Hallelujah. And just as the Jews were rescued, God rescued you and I. Time and time again, though, the Israelites, we read, after God rescued them, they went back into the same lifestyle again and again and again and again. God would send prophets, says, turn from your wicked ways. Stop worshiping these idols. Stop following the habits of this nation which I've rescued you out of. Don't be like them. Be separate. Be holy. You're my holy people. And he did that again and again and again. They kept failing. And it's the same thing with you and I. God has rescued us out of this lifestyle, the world that... Praise the Lord. How many of you guys are grateful that he rescued you from the lifestyle that you had? I meant the addictions, the attitudes, the heart, the mind, you name it. God comes in and gives us a new spirit. Hallelujah. And so Christians today, God gives you a new life. He lives within us. He leads us by his Holy Spirit. And he does not want us to go back to those old deeds of sin. And here's where the problem is. We do. And the statistics reflect that. The statistics of what's going on in the world, the terrible things, it reflects that the church keeps going back to the old slave, right? Hallelujah. God's going to set us free from that. You're going to be so victorious. You're going to be an overcomer. And when the Word of God says you're more than a conqueror, it's not just talking about I conquered. No, you are more than a conqueror. You're above a conqueror. And that's what we have, and we can walk in that. And I want to encourage you to know that, because the devil's saying, well, yeah, well, you've got this problem. And so he tries to steal that from you. We are more than conquerors through Jesus. And one of the tools that God does in our lives and bringing out holiness is this. It's a tool called separation. One of the tools in the sanctification, the process of him making us more and more holy, more like Jesus Christ, that's the process. It's not an overnight thing. It's a process. One of the tools that God uses is called separation. Separation. If you have your Bibles, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 6 in your Holy Bible. Go to verse 14. And actually, if you don't have it, we'll have it up here as well. But I encourage you to mark up your Bible. And it starts right here. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial? I can't pronounce that rightly, but this is another name for Satan. So what harmony is there between Jesus and the devil? What harmony is there? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will live with them, and I will walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. Therefore, come out from them and be separate. There it is. Says the Lord, touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father to you. Hallelujah. And you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. This important doctrine of separation has been misused and abused for a long time by the church. Sometimes we take it to one extreme. Well, we think separation means isolation. Just us and nobody else. Come over here. Quick, hide. Don't let them see you. We're all here, right here in the church. Quick, shut the doors. You know, don't let them in. Stay away from them. You know, all that kind of stuff. That sort of thing. You know, don't even work with them. Don't talk with them. That's some of the extremes that Christians have gone to as far as separation. That is an extreme. And that's not what God wants for us. The other extreme is this. We accept them all. I mean, we're to be friends with the world. We're to be friends with people. And we're, you know, be around because we can't leave this world yet. But listen to me. One extreme, total isolation. The other extreme, we accept everything that you have. We accept you and we accept everything that you're doing. We accept everything that you believe. Come on in. There's a place for you here and we all love each other. And next thing you know, the church doesn't look anything like what God has called it to be. It looks like the world more than anything else. Both of these are extremes in this word of separation that God does not want us to follow. Let's look at verse, we're going to look at this a verse at a time. Verse 14, the first part of it says, do not be yoked together with unbelievers. So this is something that God wants to teach us. What does it mean to be separate? So we don't abuse it, right? We want to learn the right way. So one of the things that God says is do not be yoked to unbelievers. And in doing this, Joe Knotts, would you please come here? The big and mighty Joe, there he is. Will you come up here, Miley? Miley Rube, will you guys give it up for them right there? Stand right here, guys, facing that direction. You come up here. Right next to, yes. All right. Now, a yoke is this. A yoke would go on the shoulders of the animal. And what it would do, it would cause them to, like when one turns this way, the other one would have to turn also. When one stops, the other stops also. When one goes, the other one has to go also. So they are bound together in a very strong, tight relationship. You see what I'm saying? I looked all over. I called my Mennonite neighbors. I called my Amish friends. I've called all these people, and I could not find one. So what we have here, this is really not a yoke, but it's made to bring things together, okay? So we're just going to pretend. We're going to put this on his shoulder, and we're going to put it on. Now, you guys got to hold it, okay? You guys got to hold it right there. There you go. You're going to have to get together. There we go. Now, when they yoke animals together, they usually did like two mules, two oxen, or two horses. And here's one of the things I've learned, and I don't know how accurate this is. If a horse could pull 2,000 pounds, how many pounds do you think two horses could pull? Well, I would think 4,000, but actually it's closer to like 6,000 and even more. It's like, whoa. So being yoked together is a good thing if you guys look comfortable. Being yoked is a good thing. See, I wanted to have the one that went around your neck, you know. I really wanted that so bad. This actually came from the museum, and they had those horse collars, you know, with the big horns on the side. But they were all ratty, and they still smelled like the horses that had them on. So I didn't do that. But two horses, they go well together. They work well together. And one goes, the other goes, one stops, the other stops, and it just keeps going on. And they go at the same pace even. That's a good thing. That's a close relationship. But the concept of being unequally yoked, God says, there's some things you can be yoked to, but I don't want you being yoked to some other things. And if you are, if you're in a close relationship, that's unequally yoked. Does this look equally yoked? No. So it's kind of an idea of this. Bible says you must, actually this idea of unequally yoked comes from Deuteronomy 22:10, and it says this, you must not plow with an ox and a donkey harnessed together. Now I'll let you guys decide who's who. Okay, one's a donkey, one's an ox. And by the way, in the Bible, the ox was considered a clean animal and the donkey was not considered a clean animal. Did not want to bring them together. Not only that, they didn't have the same nature. And when you yoke them together, it was a cruel thing because they would fight. They couldn't pull at the same strength. They couldn't pull at the same time. They was arguing all the time, kicking each other. I don't know. But this is what we have right here. I mean, we look at this, we think, man, we're not going to get much work out of these guys whatsoever. We might as well just give it up. But it was cruel to bind them together. People being yoked together. When people are yoked together, it's two people who come together in a very close relationship. Remember, what one does, the other one follows along. Right? And that's the whole concept behind God says, don't be yoked to unbelievers. You're different. It's not because you're better. See, I'm not better. But my God is holy, and this world is unholy. And God doesn't want me to be yoked to unholiness so that I do what unholy people do. Does that make sense? Hallelujah. All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. I was going to ride you, but hey. I was going to ride him, but it didn't work out. So the Bible says it's wrong for believers and unbelievers to be yoked together. You could be neighbors. You could be friends. You could work together. But this closeness, this following each other, no, no. You got to be separate. God did not want his people whom he had rescued to mingle again with the pagan nations of Canaan. He rescued them from the pagans. He did not want them to mingle with them. And what happened? Again and again they mingled together. They repeatedly disobeyed. How did they do it? Listen to this. This is how they were yoked to these unpagan people, to these pagan people. They had business dealings with them, business ties. They would go into business together. Yeah. It's not good to go in business with someone that's unequally yoked with you. Amen. Even if you're both believers, but you know what I'm saying? It's not good. They went into business ties together. They celebrated holidays together. They would come over and they would celebrate their pagan holidays that was going on. They started marrying with the people. They gave their children to their children and they started marrying to them. You know, that, listen to me, young person, do not be unequally yoked in your marriage. Do not be. Don't think, I'm going to change him. I'm going to change him. If he needs change right now, you ain't doing it. Only God can change that man. Amen? There's a saying, it goes, women marry men hoping that they can change him, and men marry women hoping they never change. Okay, anyway, that's something different. Okay, anyway. So how were they yoked to the people? By business ties, doing business together, being partners, celebrating their pagan holidays, marrying, and eventually what happened? They prostituted themselves to these gods. They started worshiping these idols. Can you imagine, God? The best way I could describe it is this. Girls, wives, you have a husband. You trust him. He's a good guy. He's at work with these other guys. And now after work, they want to go out to the strip club and just relax. And your husband calls. He wants to go along. How would you feel? I mean, he's faithful. He'll come home. You trust him. But do you want him in that land? Do you want him in that environment? No, you don't. You better not. Amen? It's the same way with God. When we go after the things of this world and we long to do the things of this world and we long to be a part of it and enjoy the same things they do, celebrate the same things they do, man, that breaks God's heart. We've been set apart. We've been saved. He rescued us for himself, not for ourselves. God rescued you for himself, not for yourself. He loves you. And so we belong to him, and so we don't want to prostitute. And eventually, girls, you know what would happen if that husband of yours kept going to this club and drinking and after work with these guys who don't love, they don't have a wife, they don't care if he loves you or not. Eventually, he will fall victim to it. Right? Amen? It's the same way. Does that make sense? All right. How have Christians yoked themselves to the world? Listen, I'm going to say some things, and my intent here is not to step on toes. My intent here is to give you the truth. I'm not here. Please listen. I don't sit here and write this stuff thinking, oh, they need to hear this. Oh, they need to hear. I don't do that. I don't do that at all. I think that's wrong. It's manipulation, and that's not of God. God can do it, not me. So if I say some stuff here, it's because God loves you. I'll offer some very obvious ones because they are very obvious. Number one, how is it that Christians yoke themselves to the world? With this homosexual lifestyle. Hey, it's okay. I understand, you know, look, we've been fighting this for a long time. It's okay. Matter of fact, you can be in the church. You can have leadership. Yeah, they're welcome to be in the church, but they can't be members. But we allow them to even preach. We allow them with that lifestyle to do those things. We embrace the homosexual. We put their color flag on our social media page. You're embracing it. You're promoting it. Don't do that. Sex outside of marriage. God says sex is good, and we know that. And then God put it within the marriage, and that's the best and the safest. But when we have sex outside of it, that's not God's plan for our lives. Living together, that's not God's plan for our lives. God loves us. He wants us, and that's the world, getting drunk, getting wasted. Well, what does the Bible say about drinking? I'm not talking about drinking. I'm talking about getting drunk. I'm talking about getting wasted. The Bible says we have a mind, and he wants us to be in control of our mind. He does not want us to give control of our mind over to anything else. Isn't it interesting? It's called spirits. And when you do that, you're giving yourself over to spirits of this world. Same thing with drugs. Drugs, another word for drugs is pharmaceutical. That's where we get it. And when we use drugs, we are opening up our hearts and our lives and our minds to spiritual influence, demonic influence. God says, that's not for you. I love you. You're my people. Recreational drugs. Business dealings that lead to dishonesty. You know, these are things that Christians, that's how we yoke ourselves to the world. Next thing you know, in order to get this deal done, we're doing the same things they're doing. No. Come out from among them. Other ways to God. Sometimes in the church we say, man, there's other ways to God. I mean, Jesus is a way, but you know what? There's some other ways as well. There's no other way. Only Jesus died for our sins. And if you die without Jesus, you're going to have to stand before God with your sins on you. And you're going to pay the price. Jesus is the only way. Because he is. I can't say the other way, because he is. We yoke ourselves when we have boyfriends and girlfriends who are not walking with the Lord. It's okay for a non-married person to marry a non-married person. It's okay for a Christian to marry a Christian. But it's not okay for a non-married person to marry a Christian. It's not okay because you're unequally yoked. I used to teach youth, and I was a youth pastor. And one of the things is like, well, I'm going to lead them to, you know, you could be friends with them, but you don't yoke yourself with them. You don't go and celebrate and do the things they're doing. You don't participate. So many times we think, like I said, when I'm a youth pastor, I have one kid stand on a chair and one on the ground, and you try to see, if I'm going to pull you up on a chair, I'm going to make you better. And the one on the ground says, I'm going to pull you down, I'm going to bring you to my level. Who's going to win? The one on the ground. Hallelujah. So boyfriend and girlfriend, marrying, roommates, business partners, a relationship that requires compromise. Any relation that requires compromise, that's how we start yoking ourselves to the world. Let's continue. Verses 14, second half into 16. So, for what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Jesus and the devil? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? And what agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. Paul right here lists multiple contrasts, and these are stark contrasts, are they not? We're looking at light, darkness, righteousness, wickedness, Jesus, Satan. These are contrasts. And we think, well, they're not that bad. Listen to me. They're not that bad. Or, one of the things is this, it's not just the people, it's the deeds. And so many times when we think, well, I'm not supposed to be yoked with this person, it's, yeah, you're not supposed to be yoked with that person, but you're also not supposed to be yoked with the deeds that they're doing. You could do the deeds at home by yourself. Does that make sense? And so we're not to, and it's not that God wants us to hate those people. No, we're supposed to be in those people's lives, but we're not to be yoked with them to the point that we're influencing, they're influencing our lives, they're influencing our family, they're influencing our thinking, and next thing you know, we're believing what they're believing, and then we're led astray. And we've lost. So God does not want us to be doing that sort of thing. How can you possibly bring these opposites together? Light, darkness, righteousness and wickedness, Christ and Satan. You can't. When we try to walk with the world and God at the same time, here's what happens. We break spiritual fellowship with God. We create discord and division. Let's continue on. Verse 17. Therefore, let's read this one line together. 1, 2, 3. Come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. God commands his people to come out. And when you read that word, come out, it implies a defiant act on our part. When God tells you to come out, it's just like, I'm coming out. It's not like, well, I got to go. I'll talk to you later. I'll be right back. I got to go. No, it implies come out. Turn your back on them. Walk away on those deeds, on those people who want to just drag you down. Hallelujah. And it says, be ye separate, which also suggests this. It's a devotion to God. When we read be ye separate, many times we think that's a negative act. It's a positive act towards God. Be separate. Oh, God, they won't like me. Do you care what I think, says the Lord? Are you placing what they want above what I want for your life? Did they die for you? Did they rescue you from what you were going to go to hell in? Did they do that for you? And now you want to make them happy? That's called political correctness. Get out of it.
Oh, he's talking politics.
No. Okay. Political correctness is wrong. Amen. I believe it's right from hell. I believe it's right from hell. When you are forced to act the way they want you, the way the mob wants you to act. And let me tell you right now, the mob is not concerned about what God wants. I'd rather be spiritually correct. Amen? God is good. Yes. Stop it. Okay, here we go. When we yoke ourselves to the world, we'll also suffer the judgment of the world. Let me tell you a story, true story, by a man by the name of John Ramirez. He was a guy who was brought into Satan worship. His dad was into Satan worship. His dad was murdered. His mom took him to a tarot card reader, and they started reading the tarot cards, and she says, oh, you need to get this guy. You need to do this spell over him, or he's going to go blind. Stay away from tarot cards. They're not from God. They're from hell, and they're meant to pull you away. Don't be yoked with the spiritual things like that. Be yoked to Jesus. Anyway, so they did these spells upon him, and then he surrendered his life to the devil and started calling him Father and started doing all kinds of things. Very sick, very wicked things. And he felt the power. He felt, I'm somebody's now. I'm somebody now. That's how the devil deceived him. And he did all kinds of things. And one of the things he says that he would do, and by the way, we're calling you to go out and witness to people and bring them to church or tell them about Jesus Christ. He says the church of Satan was way more organized than the church of God. The church of Satan was way more sold in to the idea of what they had to do. They were committed way more than the church of God. And it says, we, mayors, lawyers, senators, doctors, and all these famous people, police chiefs, we would come together and we would do these rituals. And one of the things that he liked to do was this. He loved to go to the clubs. He loved to go to the bars where people were indulging in the world. And he says, and I loved, and I would sit there, and I would look for the Christian that was in that club. Okay, that's being yoked to the world. That's being yoked to the world. And he says, I would look for them, and I would go up to him, and I would say, hey, I have a word for you. And they go, yeah, what is it? He goes, at that moment, they've opened up the door for me to speak into their lives. And I would give them a curse that the devil told me to give to them. And he goes, and I would curse Christians all the time. They're the easiest prey. The ones that were in the clubs. The ones that were yoked to the world. The ones who are enjoying the things of the world and not separating themselves from the world, but being a part of it. Those were the ones that he would come up and curse. Do you think those ones were protected under the blood of Jesus Christ? I doubt it. I mean, the blood of Jesus, I'm not here to say yay or nay, whatever, but I'm just telling you right now, how many of you guys would want to be in that position? The devil is a real person. The devil has real power. But as a believer, there are some things that we don't belong to. And if you are a believer, if you're a child of a police officer, but yet you still play in the street, it doesn't matter if you're a child of a police officer. You're in the street, you're going to get hit. If you're a child of God and you're out in the world and playing in the world, it doesn't matter if you're a child of God. You're going to get hit. Stay out of that stuff. And that's exactly what they would do. Hallelujah. Hold on a second. I'm lost. Yeah, I know that, but I'm lost on here. Thank you. She's paying attention. Star for you. Yeah. So, listen. When you may be in a situation where you're living a certain way, and you feel like, I can't get out. Get out. God loves you. Find a way out. Get out. The reason why we stay in is like, I can't do that. I just can't get out. It'll really mess things up. It'll mess up my payments. It'll mess up my relationship. It'll mess up my friendship. It'll mess up my job. It'll mess up a bunch of things. And, you know, I won't be liked anymore. Stop. Stop. Amen? Get out of it. So the nature of a believer, with this I'm going to be closing. There's a different nature between us and the world. Number one, we have a nature. A pig grass and do what sheep do. A Christian has a divine nature. Isn't that awesome? We no longer have the nature of the world. We have a divine nature. Why is that? Because God has given us His Holy Spirit inside of our spirit. We've got a new nature. We don't have to be like the rest of the world. We can be what God has called us to be. We have a divine nature. And we, listen to this, we should want to associate with only what pleases God, not with what pleases the world. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm not just talking about people. I'm talking about the deeds that we do as well and the deeds that they do as well. So what I want to do, and this is the thing that's been playing in my head all week long. I have a divine nature. Not because I'm good. Because who's in me is good. You have a divine nature, not because you're good, because who's in you is good. So I'm going to put this up here. There it is. This is what I want you guys to learn and read to yourself. It may be awkwardly worded, but that's how I talk. Okay, here we go. Let's say it together. 1, 2, 3. I have God's holy nature in me, so I will not be yoked to unbelievers or associate with the deeds of unbelievers. Come you out from among them. Be ye separate from them. When we do that, we're going to be different. And you're like, you're going to stand out. You're going to stand out. And the world's going to take notice. And they're going to mock you. They're going to ridicule you. But they're also going to come up to you when no one else is looking and say, will you pray for me? Hallelujah. They will do that. And that's when, why is it? Because they see a different nature in you. You're not like them. And they like what they see. They've heard other Christians, and they've seen how they behave, and they think, I don't want anything to do with that. You're a fake. You're a phony. As a matter of fact, I don't want your Jesus. Get away from me. And that's the reason why we feel we can't witness to people, because we're not separate. We're yoked to the world. We've not walked out of it. We're still living like the world in our deeds. Amen. So that's what God wants to heal us and deliver us. He wants to set us free from all that as well. So remember, you have a divine nature. It's not just stay away from people. Listen, it's stay close to God. Stay close to God. I want to close with just by reading these things. Don't connect with anything that will compromise your testimony or lead you into disobedience. And this is the thing that really stuck out to me. If you continue to compromise on the little things that you know that God has called you to do, listen, if you compromise on that thing, well, I'll do everything else, but I can't do this because I'm stuck in what I'm doing. If you continue to compromise on that little thing there, there'll be a time, just like the children of Israel, where you'll turn your whole heart against God. Amen? You'll walk away. God's heart cries out for us as well. If you continue to compromise in God's commandments for our lives today, we will compromise in our relationship with Him tomorrow. We want to live our lives in such a way that the world is drawn to our Savior and not indifferent towards Him. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for rescuing us. Forgive us of our sins. Lord God, please speak to me where I've hurt you, you know, where I've compromised in my relationship with you. Please speak to me. I want to walk away. I want to walk away from that lifestyle. I want to surrender to you. And so, Lord God, I give you my heart. I give you my obedience. And how do you know if God has your heart? Is if you obey him in the small things. Jesus says, if you love me, obey me. And it's not because he has to be obeyed. It's because he is holy and this world is not. And when we're holy and we go after God with all of our hearts, then his holiness shines through us. And the world recognizes it for what it really is. And they will be drawn to Jesus. They'll be saved. And you will have a testimony. You will have a witness that will reach the world and change them. Hallelujah. God is so good. So Lord, say, make this your prayer. Lord, just forgive me for my sins. And Lord, help me to do the hard things that I know I need to do. Forgive me. In Jesus' name. Give me the courage. Give me the strength to walk away. Give me the courage and the strength to break that yoke that I have with things that I should not be in. Those statistics that was talked about earlier, Lord God, may it not be of me anymore. That may be the old me, but not the new me. Because I'm surrendered to a good God. I'm surrendered to a God who's rescued me and redeemed me and set me apart. Lord, you're good. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. As you guys are still bowing and eyes are closed, I just want to offer this up to someone. There may be someone here today who is not a Christian, not a believer. God loves you. He wants to see you in heaven. He gave his, so much so that he gave his son so that you could be in heaven. And if you give your heart to Jesus, he accepts you right where you are right now. And he makes you clean on the inside. And then he's patient and he will work it out of you so it's on the outside as well. But let it start on the inside. If you're here today and you're not a Christian, you want to give your life to Jesus or you want to rededicate your life to Jesus, would you please just slip your hand up? We're going to just pray together out loud, okay? I see that hand. Anybody else? I see that hand too. Anybody else want to give their life? I see that hand. There's, praise the Lord. All right, four. Holy Spirit's working here. Five. Thank you, God. Holy Spirit's working here. Why? Because he loves you so. Hallelujah. Let's pray this prayer together, shall we? Let's, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for loving me when times I don't love myself. Thank you for loving me when I don't love you. Please forgive me for my sins. I need your forgiveness in my life. I surrender to you. You can have all of me. Thank you. Come in. Make me new as you promised. And Lord, I will follow you. I will follow you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap there.
We hope you've enjoyed today's message. If you have made a decision to accept Christ as your Savior or in need of prayer, we would like to hear from you. Please contact us at either 574-223-7631 or email us at admin@faithoutreach.cc. For further information on our church, go to our website at www.faithoutreach.cc or like us on Facebook. Either way, you will find information on upcoming events, archived sermons, who we are, as well as other activities going on here at Faith Outreach Center. On behalf of Faith Outreach Center, this is Roger Vogel saying, God bless and thanks for listening.